I like the fact that you like to dig deep in your topics. I mean, I guess even more advanced than quanta, which is really good. There's not that much out there that does this. That's why I appreciate what you're doing so much.
Okay, well, let's dig deep. What are some different ways that people use machine learning? So, for instance, Terry Tao uses it as an assistant to proofs, but also to generate conjectures and perhaps to even point to existing tools that he may not have heard of. And those are more of the LLM sort. Then there's another sort of just finding patterns in large data sets, and that connects to your murmuration conjecture. Is there a third category?
Yeah, that's right. So I was just trying to, I think I outlined this briefly last time, you're just trying to, because this is exactly the kind of thought process that's going on, how to categorize the different approaches. And of course, they're all interrelated and it's hard to delineate them. But so this is my, you know, my top down mathematics is this intuition guided basis of mathematical research. And this LLM approach is what I called meta mathematics. And this is kind of LLM, you know, LLM assisted co-pilots that Terry Tao is talking about. And then this third category of, you know, bottom up, where not necessarily any AI is involved. This is, I'm thinking about things like lean provers and proofers co-pilots, where you just have millions of lines of code. And well, sooner or later, somebody's going to process that by AI. The interplay between these three directions and between that and the human is clearly beginning to change the landscape of mathematical research.
Now, before we get into your presentation here, you mentioned on another talk, on another, either an article or a podcast, I don't recall from my research, that there are two types of researchers. One is a bird and another is a hedgehog. And you're more of the type that likes to fly and connect. I'm also similar. So I think that's one of the reasons we get along so well and that the audience loves you. But tell us more about this.
Yeah, I think there are various tributes to this quote. I think it originated from a Greek fable where the fox and the hedgehog are compared, where the fox knows a lot of things and the hedgehog likes to dig in. And I think the great mathematician Arnold made a reference to this in classifying mathematicians, where he calls things like, you know, one is an eagle that flies and tries to see the landscape, and then the hedgehog digs deep to one particular problem, solves it. I mean, there's no particular, neither is superior to the other. It says we definitely need both, and each mathematician can function as both. But certainly, AI is helping us in both personalities, simply because there's so much literature out there. The AI can have an overview of what everything is in terms of the literature, and also there's so much technical detail. There's some very boring parts of the proof that you just simply don't have time to iron out, and that can certainly be helped by LLM models. And it is beginning to do that. I was actually just at a conference last week in Exeter. There was a conference called the Impact of AI for Mathematics, where the organizer Madhu Das, and she was saying that she's a number theorist, and she said she's just recently completed this very complicated paper, where she had a proof lemma. And then what she did was she knew there's another lemma which has got to be true.
Okay.
And so what she did was she copy and pasted the entire proof of her lemma, it's a bit technical stuff, into ChatGPT 01, and then said, now can then copy the lemma and said, can you supply the basic proof strategy of this lemma, which I know to be true. Now, to be fair, this is very far from automated reasoning. This is just language model. And then what she did was, and then she went line by line, symbol by symbol, the proof that ChatGPT gave her for the big long lemma. And it was largely correct. And with a bit of prompting, she was actually able to nudge out a complete version of that proof. And then that was done. I mean, so it would have taken her much longer to have ironed out all the details herself.
Wow.
So this is really rather impressive. And this is only because of O1. And O1 came out, I think, this year or end of last year. So it's really transforming the kind of stuff. The boring stuff you can delegate, and also the pattern recognition part you can also delegate. So we become like superhuman all of a sudden, and can interact with these agents who can help us actually do research and not just very elementary problems now, but serious research level mathematics.
Why don't you talk about some of your personal use cases? So do you use ChatGPT more than Claude, or do you use Gemini more than the others? Like, what is your mixture?
In terms of research, to be honest, prior talking to her, I never even really played around with chat, this kind of LLMs to help with my research. I didn't know that was as possible. I know, it's the kind of thing you can, if you want to know very quickly a topic, you can go to Wiki, you can Google, but indeed, ChatGPT or DeepSeek will probably answer your question very quickly. If there's some theorem that you've just forgot, or there's a field that you really don't want to know about it, DeepSeek will summarize it much more efficiently than if I went to some expert and wasted his or her time and just have that. The process is much more efficient if I just wanted a very quick overview of some specialized topic. So that's been very, very helpful to me.
So it's only been 3 years since ChatGPT came out, and already we're seeing this massive change in the landscape.
Yeah.
Do you imagine that 3 years from now, or let's say 10 years from now, that the role of the future academic or intellectuals or mathematicians, if you want to specialize, will be of a decider or director, like a curator rather than a doer? So the doer is the one that right now we use computation, we use syntax, we come up with some proof, but the decider would be one that just, okay, it governs.
Yep.
It says, this is what you should do.
Compute already helped us a lot by the end of the 20th century. So no professional mathematician really goes, by the 90s and early 2000s, no professional mathematician, for example, does boring integrals anymore during research, because that's completely outsourced to, say, something like Wolfram Mathematica and then later SageMath, because this is just boring and we know how to do it. It will take us many hours if we really want to grind out some technical integral. Of course, I'm not saying that you shouldn't teach undergraduates integrals anymore, because that's part of the learning process, and it's still important to teach undergraduates this kind of thing. But no professional mathematician will start. They're really boring and horrible things. Like even the simplest thing, sine 17x. Nobody really wants to go on it. It's just type into Mathematica, because if I just need that result very quickly, so I can supplant my next step of what I envision in my paper, I'm not going to waste a couple of hours trying to integrate something very elementary. And I'll probably even get it wrong. There'll be factors wrong. That already transformed it. So I can see 10 years from now, simple, basic, maybe, well, I'm being conservative here, but simple bits of a proof or simple bits of a derivation can just be outsourced to the likes of ChatGPT or DeepSeek or something even more specialized. We don't currently have an LLM just for mathematics. That's surely going to come very soon. I'm sure the Frontier Math Project by Epoch AI will start providing this kind of services.
Okay, well, let's get into your presentation on the AI mathematician.
Yeah, sure. Well, thank you. So I guess, last time we talked about various things, and I just want to share more in this chat some of the capabilities, both in the terms of top down and bottom up of what we're looking at. And to be honest, even since our conversation, which was 5 months ago, the field has advanced significantly, which is very, very impressive. So just briefly, as I was saying last time, and I just as I also just mentioned, I try to classify this in this review article, these three directions of mathematics. Of course, they are intertwined, and the memorization conjectures that I did with my collaborators Lee, Oliver, and Posnikov is really a very good example of this top-down, and I'll explain why. This top-down mathematics is one that I want to emphasize here, and then I will go back to just refresh people's mind a little bit about how people like Terence Tao and all these great and top minds are doing proof assistance in terms of what I would call bottom-up and mathematics. This is a very, very interesting point where I want to emphasize, you know, the typical mathematician, or and that includes theoretical physicists, historically, we do things top-down by just looking at patterns and spotting patterns. And we do many things in terms of practice before foundation. And this is very important. This is something that can't really be formalized. Because, you know, linguistically trying to formalize mathematics, and which is an extremely important program, right? And all of these benchmarkings of problem solving using large language models, this is when you have a precise, well-defined problem and trying to find a solution.
Yes.
But the history of scientific discovery is certainly not that. I would say probably more than 50% is actually finding the problem or have a vague notion of something before you can formalize it.
Can you give an example?
So, for example, for example, Newton invented calculus without any notion of what even convergence means. He just had this intuitive idea of motion. And then because it was Newton, he intuited there is this thing called derivative. This is way before we could even have epsilon delta limits, which came in the 19th century, almost 300 years later. And algebraic geometry is something closer to my heart. Algebraic geometry was started with the Apollonius and Euclid, with just, you know, shapes and stuff. And we can intuitive the kind of theorems we want to prove before this Bourbaki school in the 1950s and 1960s, you know, the height of the Bourbaki school, tried to formalize that in terms of definitions of fields and rings and polynomial rings and ideals. And this is how theoretical discovery has always happened. In some sense, this is the reason I want to emphasize this bit is that not only just because this is one I'm most familiar with and the one that I suppose I've been mostly involved with. Another reason I want to emphasize is that it's hard to imagine how AI can help us with this because it's so vague and it's so human. And there's a lot of mistakes. And if you train some language model, there's not even any data to train on because these are not formal proofs. These are just grasps of ideas, of intuition. And the point I want to make that is that even in this direction, AI is beginning to help us.
This was just a teaser. The full podcast is in the description. As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.